Putnam Berkeley Audio presents Secret Prey by John Sandford, read by Stephen Lang.
The chairman of the board pulled the door shut behind him, stacked his rifle against the log-sided cabin, and walked down to the end of the porch. The light from the kitchen window punched out into the early morning darkness and the utter silence of the woods. 2 weeks of nightly frost had killed the insects and had driven the amphibians into hibernation. For a few seconds, he was alone. The chairman yawned and unzipped his bib overalls, unbuttoned his pants. Nothing like a good leak to start the day, he thought. As he leaned over the low porch rail, he heard the door opening behind him. Three men and a woman filed out of the house, pretended not to notice him. "Need some snow," the woman said, peering into the dark. Susan O'Dell was a slender 40 with a tan, dry face, steady brown eyes, and smile lines. A headlamp was strapped around her blaze orange stocking cap. She wore a blaze orange Browning parka, snowmobile pants, and carried a backpack and Remington 308 mountain rifle with a loopholed Vari-X 3 scope.
"Cold son of a bitch, though," said Wilson McDonald as he slipped one heavy arm through his gunsling. McDonald was a large man and much too heavy. In his hunting suit, he looked like a blaze orange Pillsbury doughboy. He carried an aging 30-06 with open sights, bought in the 30s at Abercrombie & Fitch in New York. At 42, he believed in a certain kind of tradition. His summer car, a racing green XKE, was handed down from his father. His rifle came from his grandfather, and his spot in the country club from his great-grandfather. He would defend the Jaguar against far better cars, the 30-06 against more modern rifles, and the club against parvenus, hirelings, and of course, blacks and Jews. "You all ready?" asked the chairman of the board as he came back toward them. He was a fleshy, red-faced man, the oldest of the group, with thick white hair.
"I don't want anybody stumbling around in the goddamn woods just when it's getting good."
They all nodded. They'd all been here before.
"Getting late," said Odell. She wore the parka hood down, and the parka itself was still unzipped, but she'd wrapped a red and white keffiyeh around her neck and chin. Meant to protect an Arab from the desert sun, it was now protecting a third-generation Irish woman from the Minnesota cold. "We'd better get out there and get settled."
5:45 in the morning, opening day of deer season. Odell led the way off the porch, the chairman of the board at her shoulder, the other three men trailing behind. Terence Robles was the youngest of them, still in his mid-30s. He was a blocky man with thick black-rimmed glasses and a thin curly beard. He carried a stainless Seiko 270 mounted with a satin-finished Nikon scope. Everything he hunted with was new technology. James T. Bone might have been Susan O'Dell's brother. 40, as she was, Bone was slim, tanned, and dark-eyed, his face showing a hint of humor in a surface hard as a nut. He brought up the rear with a 243 Mauser Model 66 cradled in his left arm. Four of the five, the chairman of the board, Robles, O'Dell, and Bone, were serious hunters. The chairman's father had been a country banker. They'd had a nice rambling stone and redwood home on Blueberry Lake, south of Itasca. The deer hunt was an annual ritual. The chairman of the board had hung 20-plus bucks in his 46 years. Real men didn't kill does. Robles had come to hunting as an adult, joining an elk hunt as a 30th birthday goof, only to be overwhelmed by its emotional power. For the past 5 years, he'd hunted a half dozen times annually. Odell was a rancher's daughter. Her father owned 20 square miles of South Dakota, and she'd joined the annual antelope hunt when she was 8. During her college years at Smith, when the other girls had gone to Ivy League football games, she'd flown home for the shooting. Bone was from Mississippi. He'd learned to hunt as a child because he wanted to eat. Only McDonald disdained the hunt. He'd shot deer in the past. He was a Minnesota male, and males of a certain class were expected to do that. But he considered the hunt a pain. At the club, they'd be playing some serious gin, drinking some serious gin, and here he was about to climb a tree. "God damn it," he said aloud. "What?" the chairman grunted. "Nothing. Stray thought,"
MacDonald said. They pushed out into the trees. 50 yards from the cabin, Odell switched on her headlamp, and the chairman turned on a hand flash. Dawn was an hour away, but the sky was clear.
Great night, Bone said.
A small lake lay just downslope from the cabin. They followed a shoreline trail for 150 yards, moved single file up a ridge, and continued still parallel to the lake. The ridge separated the lake and a tamarack swamp. 50 yards further on, Roble said,
I guess this is me,
and turned off to the left toward the swamp. He said,
good luck, guys,
and disappeared down a narrow trail toward his tree stand. The chairman of the board was next. Another path broke to the left toward the swamp, and he took it, saying,
see you.
Get the buck, said Odell, and MacDonald, Odell, and Bone continued on. The chairman switched on his flash and followed the narrow beam 45 yards down a gentle slope to the edge of the swamp. One stumpy bur oak stood at the boundary of the swamp. The chairman took out a nylon parachute cord, looped it around his rifle sling, leaned the rifle against the tree, and began climbing the foot spikes. The chairman clambered into the stand 15 feet up the tree and settled into the bench. The stand looked like a suburban deck with a 2x4 railing that served as a gun rest. The chairman slipped off his pack, hung it from a spike to his right, and pulled the rifle up with the parachute cord. The cartridges were still warm from his pocket as he loaded the rifle. That wouldn't last long. Temperatures were in the teens with an icy wind. The chairman half-dozed as he sat in the tree waiting for first light. He woke once more to the sound of a deer. The animal settled on the hillside behind him. Now that was interesting. 40 or 50 yards away, no more, still up on the ridge, but it should be visible after sunrise if it moved again. If it didn't, he'd kick it out on the way back to the cabin. He sat waiting. The chairman sighed. So much to do. The killer was dressed in blaze orange and moving quietly and quickly along the track. Dawn was not far away, and the window of opportunity could be measured in minutes. Here, now 24 steps down the track. 1, 2, 3, 23, 24. A tree here to the left. Wish I could use a light. The oak tree was there, and just to the right, a little hollow in the ground behind a fallen aspen. Just get down here, quietly, quietly. Did he hear me? These leaves sound like I'm walking on cornflakes. Where's that log? Must be right here. Must be. Ah. From the nest in the ground, the fallen aspen was at exactly the right height for a rifle rest. A quick glance through the scope. Nothing but a dark disk. What time? 6:17. Okay, settle down. And listen. If anybody comes, may have to shoot. There'd be only one run at this. There were other people nearby, and they were armed. If someone else came along and saw the orange coat crouched in the hole. If they came while it was dark, maybe I could run, hide. But maybe if they thought I was a deer, they'd shoot at me. What then? No. If someone comes, I take the shot then, whoever it is. Two shots are okay. It wouldn't look like an accident anymore. But at least there wouldn't be a witness. What's that? Who's there? Somebody? The killer strained to hear, but the only sounds were the dry leaves shaking in the wind. Check the watch. Getting close now. Nobody moving. I'm okay. Have to think about the old man. If he's there at the cabin, I'll have to take him. And if his wife's there, have to take her. That's okay. They're old. Still nothing in the scope. Where's the sun? Daniel S. Kresge was the chairman of the board, president, and the chief executive officer of the Polaris Bank System. 250 banks spread across 6 Midwestern states, all wrapped in his cost-cutting fist. If everything went exactly right, he would hold his job for another 15 months, when Polaris would be folded into Midland Holding, owner of 600 banks. There would be some casualties. The combined bank's central administration would be in Fort Worth. Not many Polaris executives would make the move. In fact, the whole central administrative section would eventually disappear, along with much of top management. Bone would probably land on his feet. His investments division was one of the main profit centers at Polaris. Odell ran the retail end of Polaris. Midland would need somebody who knew the territory, so she could wind up as the number two or three person in Midland's retail division. Would she take it? Kresge was not sure. Robles would hang on for a while. A pure technician, he ran data services for Polaris, and Midland would need him to help integrate the Polaris and Midland data systems. McDonald was dead meat.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.